I want to begin the conversation by talking a little bit about the history of our profession. I've been around since the beginning, which marks me as an old guy. We began with something called a database management system. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought about a database management system, but what is the primary purpose of a database management system? What is a database management system optimized for? And if you look carefully, you will find that a database management system is optimized for storing, managing, and looking at transactional data. Now, what do we mean by transactional data? A simple example is a bank transaction. You walk into the bank, you tell them who you are, you give them your account number, you say, I now want to have $100 in cash or some amount that you would like to have. The bank checks your activity, your account out, and then gives you your $100, if of course you have that much in your account. And so that's a typical transaction. When it comes to the computer records the transaction. And what does the computer record? Well, it records some basic information. It records the date. It records your name. It records your account number. It records how much money was involved in the transaction, and perhaps a few other pieces of information. And then the bank goes and processes the next customer. And what does the bank record in the database for the next customer? The bank records the person's name, the date, the account number, the type of the transaction, and the amount of the transaction. In other words, the same kind of transactional data gets to be recorded over and over again in the computer. And that's what database management systems are optimized for. They're optimized for storing the information. They're optimized for looking at the information and manipulating the information. And why they are so efficient is because of the uniformity of the transactional information. That in truth, there's no difference between one transaction and the next, except for the particulars, name, account number, and type of transaction. That's the only difference. So we have what's called structured data. Why is it called structured data? It's called structured data because of the fact that it's the same type of data over and over and over again. And so database management systems are designed to store structured data. They're designed to store the same data over and over again. And that's good. We need to do that. That's I'm not complaining. I'm just pointing that out. But what this doesn't do is allow for, if you will, unstructured data. When you look at the corporation and you look at the activities that go on in the corporation, what you find is that there's many, many activities in the corporation that are not structured data. We have call centers. We have email. We have contracts. There's far more non-structured data in the corporation than there is structured data. And so it's kind of interesting to ask the question, can a computer handle data that doesn't have a high degree of structure to it? And the answer is, for many years, the answer was no. That for many years, we found that trying to fit textual and unstructured data into a database management system was a very inefficient, very awkward fit. Now, you say, well, gee, Bill, we've been running our business for many years and we haven't done anything with this unstructured data. Why is that a problem? Well, I'll let you decide that, why that's a problem, at the end of this presentation, because what's happened is there's whole classes of types of data that have never, ever been subjected to the use of the computer. And now we have technology that will allow us to take unstructured data and put it efficiently into a computer. And in doing so, that opens up the opportunity for all kinds of systems and transactions and activities that never before could be computerized. And we're going to give some examples of that today. And if you're understanding what I'm saying, what this does is this opens up opportunity. This opens up the chance to have systems that we've never had before. And once we do that, there is the chance to make a lot of money. And quite frankly, everybody around the world, doesn't matter whether you're in Finland, United States, China, India, doesn't matter where you're at, everybody likes the chance to make a lot of money. So that's going to be the theme for our talk today. Now, let's talk ever so briefly about what, you know, you say, okay, Bill, thanks for telling me that there's new kinds of systems that are out there. Can you name some for me? And I can name lots of them for you. I'm not gonna waste your time talking about all of them. I'm just gonna mention a few of them. But one of them would be in restaurants and restaurant chains. It turns out that restaurants are particularly sensitive to the attitudes of their customer. If a restaurant and a restaurant chain does not listen to what their customers are saying, the restaurant chain soon finds out that they have fewer customers and they're making less money. And so restaurants are one organization that has a peculiar sensitivity to needing to listen to what their customers are talking about. Another one are airlines, especially in this day and age of the COVID disease that is around the world. I saw an article just the other day that said the airlines have lost over three quarters, 75% of the business of the airline has gone away. And so once upon a time, airlines were treating customers as if they were an inconvenience. I can give you lots of, I used to travel a lot. I can tell you personally that airlines treat their customers in a very crude and awful fashion. They may not admit it, but it's the truth. Today they're finding out that, oh my gosh, we actually need customers to make money with. And so for airlines needing to listen to what their customer is saying, to be competitive and to even stay alive in the world of airline travel, they've got to listen to their customers. But there's lots and lots of other examples of the need for being able to take text and turn text into a form that is useful and able to be processed by standard database technology, by Oracle, by SQL Server, by DB2, by Teradata, by Hadoop. We need to be able to treat those database management systems in a fashion that in a different fashion than they've ever been treated before. And can it be done in today's world? Yes, it can be done in today's world. So that's what we're going to talk about this morning. Let's go ahead and start the conversation.